Good evening, everyone. We welcome you all to OSCE webinar 28. So to go on with the webinar, I hand over the proceedings to the president of the Pediatric Orthopedic Society of India, Dr. Dhiren Ganjwal. Unmute yourself, sir.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the 28th webinar of Pediatric Orthopedic Society of India. Today we have two experts from France with us. The first is Professor Federico Canaves, who is going to speak on the two topics. And then we are really fortunate to have the expert who is a mentor of Federico, Professor Ellen DiMeglio, with us. So I will just give a brief introduction about the speaker. But if you have a question, you can ask question on WhatsApp on number 98230-63989. Professor Federico is really an international person because he is born in Italy. Then he migrated to France and he was trained under Professor Ellen DiMeglio. Then he did a pediatric fellowship from Shriner Hospital, Portland in USA. Then he went to Sick Children's Hospital, Toronto. He is a PhD, he did his PhD from Geneva, Switzerland. Then he started his practice in France. In 2017 and 18, he also visited China as a clinical professor at Guangzhou. Again, he came back to France and at present he is head of pediatric orthopedic at Ferent, France. His academic credentials are really also excellent. He has more than 150 publications and he has contributed to 8 book chapters. He is also a member of various orthopedic associations, pediatric orthopedic association. Of that, the foremost is the France Pediatric Orthopedic Society. The second is International Pediatric Orthopedic Think Tank. The another is IPOS and POSNA. This time we have invited Professor Ellen DiMeglio. He is a good friend of POSI and he is also a mentor of Professor Federico. So with the dual relationship, he is with in this webinar and he's going to give his expert comments on this topic. Just to say about Professor DiMeglio, he was a president of SICOT and very active member of IPOS. So with that, I hand over to Federico. He's going to give two short talks, each of 20 minutes. The first one will be his innovative technique of minimally invasive pelvic osteotomy. And the second one, a new topic, which has become very popular in last few years. That's a membrane-induced osteogenesis. So with that, I hand over to Professor Federico. Thank you. Over to you.
Thank you very much, and thank you very much for your kind words, and most importantly, thank you very much for the kind invitation. I'm very happy to share my thoughts with all the audience. So as you said, I'm going to have two talks. One is more about surgical technique, because I strongly believe that patients with neuromuscular condition and poor walking ability should really try to benefit of minimally invasive procedure to correct their bone deformities. And the second technique is again a talk about a surgical technique, but this is about chronic infection and non-union in children treated by the induced membrane, which you all know is a technique that was developed in France more than 3 decades ago. So if you allow me, I'm going to start with the first talk, which is the one about the percutaneous pelvic osteotomy, which is used for the treatment of acetabular dysplasia in cerebral palsy patients. So I'm going to highlight the technique, the results, and what are nowadays the indication. So the goal of surgery of this technique are to decrease the operating time, to minimize the bleeding, and still provide a good outcome to this patient. So what is important is the positioning of the patient and to identify the proper landmarks. So as you can see from these slides and from the drawing, it is important to identify the anterior and the posterior iliac spine. And
sorry to interrupt, but you need to slide share.
Share your screen.
Share your screen. We cannot see any slides.
Oh, sorry. I thought it was going on. So I have to start again or?
Yes, talk one. Yes, open it. Yes, and go to the first slide. Yes, thank you.
Yeah. Okay, sorry about that. So the introduction is already done. I'm going to talk about the PPO, pelvic percutaneous osteotomy, for the treatment of acetabular dysplasia in CP children. So as I just mentioned, the goal of surgery are to reduce the operating time and the bleeding and still provide a good outcome to these patients. So the first step is really to identify the proper anatomical landmarks and the positioning of the patient. So as you can see from the picture in the drawing, you first have to identify the anterior iliac, the anterior superior iliac spine and the posterior inferior iliac spine and the tip of the greater trochanter. So you have to imagine or draw a line joining the two iliac spines and the line perpendicular to it starting from the tip of the greater trochanter. So this step, in my opinion, is really important because you don't want to have the incision that is too anterior, because otherwise with such anterior incision, you would be too far from the sciatic notch that you have to reach percutaneously. And also you don't want to be too proximal. This is no good because you may reach and hit a branch of the superior gluteal artery and cause excessive bleeding. So really identifying the good starting point for the percutaneous pelvic osteotomy is really important. And then once you have identified these landmarks, as you can see, you do a small incision of about 2.5 to 3.5 centimeters. And then you scrape the soft tissue off from the iliac bone. So with your scissor, once you reach the bone, you really have to make sure that all the soft tissues are removed and you have free bone at the tip of your instrument. So you can also use, as in this short video, a periosteal elevator to really scrape off all the soft tissue. And what is important is that by this scraping off, as you can see here, you have to be able to reach the sciatic notch. This is important because when you will perform your osteotomy, the posterior part, the back portion of the osteotomy need to reach the sciatic notch without cutting it, because otherwise you won't be able to open the osteotomy. And to make sure that your cut is perpendicular to the bone, you have to make sure that when you control the position of your osteotom with the C-arm, it appears, as you can see here, as a perpendicular line. It means that it is really perpendicular to the source of radiation. And the cut in my hand should start about 1 centimeter above the roof of the acetabulum. And here you can see that under C-arm control, you start the cut from anterior down to posterior. And you start the cut first with a straight osteotome, as you can see here, and then you switch with the curved osteotome. And using the curved osteotome is important because you really want to give a round shape cut to the osteotomy site, and you want to reach with the tip of the osteotome the triradiate cartilage. Because as you know, the opening of the osteotomy will hinge at the triradiate cartilage. But again, if you didn't cut well the anterior portion and you didn't cut well the posterior aspect of your bone, reaching almost the sciatic notch without violating it, then it will be very difficult to open the osteotomy site. So with the C-arm control, you check that you can see your cut, and your cut, as I said again, but this is important, must be complete from anterior to posterior. And your cut should end at the level of the three radiate cartilage. Then you can put a laminar spreader into your osteotomy site and progressive opening your osteotomy site with the laminar spreader, as you can see from these sequential C-arm images. So as you can see, you put laminar spreader into the osteotomy site, then you open a little, you wait a few seconds that the bone release some of its elastic properties, and then you spread it again. So as you can see, you can open the osteotomy site of about 1.5, even 2 centimeters in some cases. But what is important, you inject the three radiate cartilage, but you want to have the medial cortex still intact. And then you have the bone graft. The bone graft comes from the femur, from the proximal femur, because before doing the pelvic osteotomy, you perform a varus derotational osteotomy, so to relocate partially or fully the head into the acetabulum. And then this small piece of bone, held by some instrument, whatever instrument you like, you slide it in between the two blades of the laminar spreader, and you fix the graft in the position you like. If you have a more posterior defect, as it is usual in CP patient, then you put the graft more in the back of your cut. On the other hand, if you happen to have some defect in the anterior part of your osteotomy, then you can slide your graft more anteriorly. But really, if you spread enough the tissue, the bone, sorry, and if you have a really scrape off the soft tissue, then from this entry point, it's quite easy to move upward or downward your graft and to position where you want. So then you have to remove, of course, the laminar spreader. And here we advocate to use some sort of protection to protect the graft, to keep it in place while removing the laminar spreader. It happened that sometimes while removing the laminar spreader, you remove also the bone graft. And here, as you can see, at the end, you position the graft where you want. And because of the elastic properties of the bone, the bone is squeezed, the graft is squeezed in between the upper and lower portion of the osteotomy, and it doesn't move. We never had to fix this graft with any kind of a wire. And patients were put sometimes into a cast, and most of the time without any contention. Here, I'm going to show you some cases with the long-term follow-up to show a little bit what this technique can achieve on the long term. So this is one of the first cases we did. So GMFCS type 5, about 4.5 years of age at the time of the osteotomy, bilateral varus osteotomy plus bilateral percutaneous pelvic osteotomy. You can see the healing at age 7, and you can see that at age 18, after having had the spine surgery, both hips remain located and the shape of the socket is quite good. Here, another case. This was a slightly older patient, age 10 at the time of surgery. Partially dislocated the hip, again, bilateral VDRSO, bilateral pelvic osteotomies percutaneous. And you can see here, 10 years down the road at age 20, both hips are located and the socket is a pretty good shape. Another case, GMFCS for patient, 6.5 at the time of surgery, fully dislocated left hip. We do bilateral VDRSO in all cases, PPO, and here you can see at age 8, both hips are inside, and at age 15, about 9 years down the road, both hips are located and the socket is pretty round. Another one case is 6.5 years, GMFCS5, bilateral dislocation with femoral head deformity, bilateral VDRSO, bilateral pelvic osteotomy, and you can see here at age 8 how the hip remodel, and 7 years down the road at age 14, both hips are in place and remain located. So these are just to share with you for the first time. I did this search when I prepared this talk for the POSI conference, and these results are not yet published and comes from myself and one colleagues of mine, Dr. De Coulon from Geneva. So together we did 78 children and we did 94 consecutive PPO and 152 associated VDRSO. So the mean age of our patient was about age 8, and the mean follow-up of all these quite significant cohort is about 5 years so far. But more than half of our patients have more than 5 years follow-up. So we calculate the mean length of surgery. So today the surgery lasts in between 12 and 18 minutes. But as you can see, at the beginning of our experience, the procedure was a little bit more lengthy. And as you can see, the learning curve goes down steadily, but we still making some progress. And now at around 15 minutes per surgery, we think we reach a sort of plateau. So as I said before, cast immobilization is not necessary unless the patient have some dyskinesia, dystonic movements, or abnormal movements. As you can see, we could correct the migration percentage, and the migration percentage remain well at last follow-up visit. The same for the acetabular angle that was corrected in a satisfactory way and remain within good range at last follow-up visit. And then we also did a comparison because some of our patients had closed triradiate cartilage and some other had still open triradiate cartilage, and we could achieve similar results between the two groups. So we think that this technique can be used also in patients that have already closed the triradiate cartilage, because as I mentioned at the beginning of my talk, all these patients are non-ambulatory. So we can take some advantage from the porotic bone of this patient with already fused triradiate cartilage and still some hinge effect when we open the osteotomy site. What are our complications? We had some complications, but they are not too much. Here I listed all the complications I found in our series. So we had one case of recurrent dislocation of the hip, but this is something that can happen whatever technique you use. We had one case of bone graft dislodgement, and this was one early case. Ever since, we never had any more case of bone graft dislodgement. We had, again, at the beginning of our experience, 4 cases of AVN, but we never had, let's say, a clue why they did happen. After these very first early cases of AVN, nothing happened, but I still have to report them. We didn't have any case of infection. And then, as I mentioned to you, you have to really reach the triradiate cartilage and hinge at the level of the triradiate cartilage. And on radiologic examination, we couldn't identify any case that had a premature closure of the three radiated cartilage. We didn't have any infection, as I said, and in 4% of cases, we had long-lasting pain. So two patients treated in Switzerland and two patients treated in France had a long-lasting pain. So when we look at the complication related to the technique, we have more or less, when we put all complications together, about 9% of complication. And then I also look at other complications that I could not link to the technique itself. We had some pathologic fracture of the femur. Mostly this pathological fracture of the femur occurred below the plate during physiotherapy. And then we had one case of that. This was a patient with severe involvement that had pneumonia ab ingestis and died because of this complication about 6 weeks after the surgery. So this is just the overview of the technique, the result we can achieve, and the complication. Another complication that I mentioned at the beginning of this talk is a lesion of the branch of the superior gluteal artery, especially if you do your incision too proximal, because this branch of the artery runs about 4 centimeters above the roof of the acetabulum. But because we do the cut at about 1 centimeter above the roof of the acetabulum, the risk of damaging it is not very high, but you have to be aware that this is a potential complication. So today, for me, the indication for this technique are severe CP patient and non-ambulatory, because we don't really know the effects of this technique on the gluteal muscles. We have been doing it in a couple of marginal ambulators. They didn't worsen their gait, but the gait was really limited. Second point that is extremely important, you have to have a reducible hip. You cannot expect to have a stable hip if the hip is not reducible. So we always recommend to make sure that the hip reduce or partially reduce before surgery. You do this check during the operation. You can treat uni or bilateral acetabular dysplasia. So unilateral or bilateral cases is the same. You can do them in the same setting. And you can treat with this technique patient with both open and closed three radiate cartilage, even though I have to say honestly, the results in patients with the closed three radiate cartilage are less predictable. Here, just a quick video I have prepared just to summarize all the concept I have explained to you, So this is a patient, GMFCS4, as you can see. The case, partial dislocation. Positioning of the patient is important. As I said, it's important to identify where to make the incision. So iliac spine, tip of the greater trochanter. You draw the two lines, one perpendicular to each other. The intersection of the two lines is where you should make the cut. Remember, it's important to make an horizontal skin incision, 2 to 3 centimeters, scrape off the tissue, and you want to have a free bone able to open and to move when the osteotomy is done. You can feel it with your finger. Your finger can also feel the back of the bone, so can reach as well the sciatic notch. Remember to see your osteotome perpendicular on the C-arm control as a straight line. You start the osteotomy with a straight osteotome, and you change then with a curved one. Then you can lever it to open the osteotomy in place. At the beginning of our technique, we used to fix the graft into a key wires, so we can use a laminar spreader or a couple of osteotomes to fix the graft. And usually you see your osteotomy, how good it was with the post-op radiographs. And here I put a case, you see this one with already closed the three radiated cartilage, and you can see how it goes over time. That in this case went well, but the results are less predictable because you have to take advantage of the porotic bone to open it. So in conclusion, older patient with a relative incongruity can also benefit from this approach. Remember, you don't want to do the incision too anterior because otherwise you will have difficulties to reach the sciatic bone. You don't want to be too proximal because you don't want to damage the superior gluteal artery. And overall, I think that this is a valuable alternative technique to standard technique. It provides similar outcome, but with less muscle stripping, less bleeding, and less time in surgery. Thank you very much.
Yeah, Federico, you can continue with the second presentation and then okay. We will take questions together.
Okay, so I think I was in 20 minutes for this one.
Yeah, that's so perfect.
I try to do the same with the second one. So this is a completely different talk. This is a talk about, you probably have your own expertise because of your patients. So I'm just trying to show you a way I've been approaching chronic osteomyelitis secondary to fracture and infected non-union by this technique.
Can we just take a few questions, otherwise we'll forget what
okay.
About
no your, problem.
Is that okay? Yeah.
I go back to
sure. I think Dhiren bhai, let's have questions related to pelvic osteotomy because the topics are completely different.
Yeah. Okay, fine. Please go ahead. Thomas, please.
Yeah. So, Federico, just a couple of comments. See, this is a very technically demanding, and I think we'll have a learning curve because my worry is doing it through such a small incision, no? Even when it's like doing a percutaneous Degha osteotomy, right? If I'm not mistaken.
Yes.
Yeah. So, even when we do it open, we have this problem of putting the lamina spreader and the graft slipping. I'm really surprised that you only had one instance of graft slippage or complications like that through such a small incision. And the other worry was whether you put a Homan retractor into the sciatic notch, because when you go with a curved osteotome, how will you know that you're not slipping into the sciatic notch and hitting the sciatic nerve?
Okay, so both are interesting questions, and there are a question that can be answered by the technique itself. Because if you perform the osteotomy and you don't break the medial cortex, once you remove the acetabular spreader, the bone graft will be squeezed in between the roof of the acetabulum and the superior part. So it won't be able to slide off. However, if the medial cortex is broken or the roof of the acetabular part, the cut is done not too far enough from the roof of the acetabulum, the bone holding the graft is too little, it doesn't provide enough stability to the graft that then can move. But really, because we used as a graft, we don't use the iliac crest, we used a piece of the femur. Because to do the VDRSO, we remove about 1.5 to 2 centimeters. So this bone is very strong because it's cortical bone. Still, if you are dealing with a patient that has cerebral palsy, is not ambulatory. And so this bone, because it's like a sort of a tricortical bone graft, is a cortical bone, very strong, can really get stuck in the osteotomy site. And the second question is about your cut. So once you reach the starting point of your osteotomy, you have to make a first straight cut from top to bottom, but not a full depth. You just have to start cutting the outer cortex. Then when you reach the inferior part, anatomically, to reach the sciatic notch, your osteotom cannot go just down, because otherwise you don't reach the sciatic notch. So you have to change the direction of your osteotomy and hit more medially, right? You have to go towards the abdomen, let's say. So this is part of the procedure. If you did your incision halfway, you can slide your finger. Your finger will reach the sciatic notch, and your cut, if you feel insecure, can go into the direction, so you will feel the corner of the osteotom sliding on the top of your finger and reaching the sciatic notch, and you will be sure that you didn't damage any structure. Once this cut is done, so you have a cut, a partial cut, going from the top down to the bottom, then you change osteotom. You take the curve osteotom, and under C-arm control, you make sure that your osteotom aims toward the triradiate cartilage. And you have to just to make sure that because the bone is not the same thickness anteriorly to posteriorly, you have to make sure to do this cut with the C-arm control so that you don't go too deep. And once the cut is performed, it's not easy, but it's possible to slide the laminar spreader that has to be again in the middle, and then you open it and your osteotomy site, as I show you in the in this slide. Yeah. Can open progressively, you see? Mm. In this case, the medial cortex was intact, but your cut reached the posterior aspect, because otherwise you cannot open. It would open only anteriorly, because if you don't cut the back, then the bone hinges at the triradiate cartilage and posteriorly. It means that it will open only on the anterior part.
Yeah, so if the triradiate cartilage is closed, yeah, how does it hinge? It will go through the medial cortex.
I call this the hinge, but it's not a hinge. We notice that when you deal with the patient with the porotic bone, you can open the osteotomy site, and the hinge would be where you end your cut. This is our clinical observation. Where your cut, where the tip of your osteotom ends, when you spread, when you open the osteotomy side, it will open at that point. But as I said, in patient with closed triradiate cartilage, you can use this technique, but somehow the results are less predictable because of this, because you don't have a certain point of opening of the osteotomy. Because in open triradiate, you know that it will hinge there. Yeah. In closed, it's a sort of a feeling, you know? But in closed triradiate cartilage.
Okay. So Federico, if I can ask you a question.
Yes.
Have you had an instance where actually when you are opening with the lamina spreader, actually the piece broke off because it was so porotic?
We had the cases, it didn't really break in two pieces, But this is a good observation, and this is the reason why over time we moved away from the roof of the acetabulum.
Okay, you go higher for the
higher cutting. Because at the beginning, when I first started this, our osteotomy was done just above the labrum.
Yes.
We used to fill the labrum and cut there. But then because of this, because it's still strong bone, I mean, it's a strong structure that you have to spread. So we moved higher up, and by moving higher up, we had better results because the bone was, like in this slide, was easier to spread.
Correct. So you had better bone stock in the inferior fragment.
Yes. Yes. This is the key. But you don't have to go too high, because if you go too high, you cannot reshape the acetabulum well.
Yes. Yes. The second question is that is there a percentage index, migration percentage index, beyond which you will not do it? What is your... Because no, all your cases are GMFCS 4 and 5.
Yes.
So how much migration you think is appropriate for doing this, or it has nothing to do with it?
He has nothing to do with the amount of migration.
Okay. Because you are going...
Sorry.
Sorry, you will do a VDRO to correct that.
After the VDRO, he'll assess it.
Yes, this is done always after the VDRSO.
So when you have an incision for the VDRSO, which is nearly to the tip of trochanter, how does the percutaneous thing help?
So this, I didn't put this part because it's a second evolution of the technique. In children under age 6, we do this osteotomy through the femoral incision.
Okay. Yeah. Okay.
Because
so only in larger kids.
Yes, this is the technique, but the patient I show were older than 6. But in younger patient,
it's the same incision.
About 10 cases already done, but we didn't. As I said, all these data are prepared for you, so are not yet published. We do through the femoral incision, because with some retractor you can pull the proximal
and get there.
Tissue, yes, and you can do the incision. So we had 10 cases or so just with the femoral incision.
Okay, and how many cases did you have to do an open reduction for the hip?
None.
You could get everything closed.
Yes. Because, as I said, but maybe this was not clear in my talk, we check the hip before we start the surgery. Okay. When the patient is asleep, we try abduction, internal, external rotation, and we see how the hips goes into the socket.
Okay.
And
okay.
we aim for reducible hips.
Okay. There is one more question. You said you do not give a spica. We have found that in CP with other contractures, especially the hamstrings and other things, and pain management becomes very difficult when they have undergone such an extensive surgery. So how do you get around that problem of not giving a spica? Do you use a brace or something?
Yes. So first, we have a very strict anesthesia protocol. So all these patients have... strong anesthetic control, and in particular they have a peridural before surgery, and then they have a local anesthetic for the incision. Then this procedure, because we are talking about GMFCS 4 and 5, usually has a soft tissue procedure that are associated. In general, we do this full cases, we do psoas lengthening, we do hamstring lengthenings, in some cases, medial or lateral, depending on the severity of the patient, adductor release, and in some cases, Achilles tendon lengthening.
Okay.
Then, so the stiffness is less. In some cases, with very high spasticity, 2 weeks before surgery, they undergo Botox in any case, because the Botox can have some antalgic effect reach the peak about 2 to 3 weeks, as you know, after the injection.
Okay, okay.
And so then we have AB duction pillow in those not having the cast, AB duction pillow, and knee immobilizer, removable.
Okay. All right, okay. So you're Botoxing them beforehand so that they are relaxed.
Yes, not everyone, but in this series, about 20% of patients had this procedure.
Okay, okay. Last question. Since it's working so well in CP hips, why aren't you doing it in DDH?
Because I don't feel comfortable. I mean, it's not a problem of the surgical skill, I think. I think okay. that this is not a difficult technique. It's just a matter of going through the abductor muscles of a patient that is fully ambulator. So okay. I really don't have the experience, or maybe I'm not brave enough to do such a surgery for a child that is working well. I mean, I don't want to create
whose abductors are otherwise okay, normal.
Yes, in a child otherwise normal, I wonder if I do this, maybe it will damage some of his walking abilities or muscle abilities. So this is the reason why, for now, I always say it's just for non-ambulatory patients. We did some marginal ambulators. We didn't have any bad surprise, but still were marginal ambulators.
Okay.
So, one more question. You talked about the time that you spent, the beginning was lots, and then when you became an expert, it became very little.
Yes.
What about the image intensify exposure, the radiation?
This is a good question. It's not too much. Again, I didn't show this data, but we check also this parameter. And actually, if I can give you a percentage, the amount of radiation exposure decrease of about 40% from the beginning till our last cases. So, but still is a procedure that requires the C-arm. You cannot do this, at least in my hand, just by feeling. You need to see how your cut goes, where you make your cut, and how much you can spread the osteotomy site. So these are points that you have to see. Okay. And for this reason, there will still always be the need of the C-arm. It's not something that we will be able to do without C-arms. And to give you you know, the C-arm, every time you take a picture, record the number of seconds of exposure. So at the beginning of our technique, the total amount of minutes was between 2 and 4 minutes. Now we are below 2 minutes, which I think is it's correct. But then the amount of rays, I cannot give you a good number because the intensity of the rays change from one case depending on the technician. So we have the amount of time, but we don't have the amount of X-rays that were actually given to each patient.
Okay.
Because it's different from one patient to another because of the machine and how you set the machine.
Okay. Thank you, Federico.
Yeah, before we just, I would like to ask Professor DiMeglio, what do you think about this technique? Like, with so much of experience, how comfortable you will be for using it?
I think that it is a very elegant surgery. The future in pediatric orthopedic is to reduce surgery, extensive surgery, and to go in the direction of mini invasive surgery. This is the future. This procedure looks simple, but in reality, there are so many details that you need a learning curve. And I think that only after 10 cases, you can control perfectly on the technical point of view, the procedure. So you have step by step to improve your technical procedure. Of course, at the very beginning, there will be a lot of irradiation, and step by step, this will decrease, you see. Second point, you have not to forget, but this is a point for the new generation, that we can avoid such a situation by preventing dislocation, by looking the first 5 years of age, the hip, by looking abduction, mobility, before such a neglected dislocation. And step by step, of course, I hope that in your society, by teaching prevention, there will be less and less surgery like this to avoid such a complex dislocation. I like to ask a question to Federico. When you do your osteotomy on the femur, you say, I combine my osteotomy by tenotomy, psoas, or adductor tenotomy. Do you do a substantial shortening also at the level of your osteotomy to decrease the tension around the hip? You see?
Yes. Yes. The technique, we in our hands, what we look is to remove the lesser trochanter, because we want to detach completely the psoas. So our femoral shortening is always at the level of the lesser trochanter, and we remove the 2 centimeters that limit above and below the lesser trochanter. So the lesser trochanter is always removed, and we are sure that the psoas won't tight back again. And again, by removing a couple of centimeters each time, of course, plus the varus, the overall length of the femur will decrease significantly, and the tension around the hip will go down as well, will decrease as well. Yes, it's part of the procedure.
Yes, I think that the shortening is a kind of decompression osteotomy for such a patient with a severe retraction around the hip. And you can combine by the shortening your osteotomy.
Because the goal, let's say, if I can say just one more thing, just to join Professor Di Meglio in what he said before, is just that probably the dream would be to have a small percutaneous varus technique in association with the pelvic osteotomy, is to have such a procedure combined, not lasting more than 30-40 minutes, all inclusive.
Great. So we look forward to a new technique for varus osteotomy coming up soon. So I think let us congratulate Dr. Federico for this wonderful session on minimally invasive pelvic osteotomy. And let's move on to the next talk.
Okay, so you can see the slide this time?
Yeah.
Yes.
So now I'm going to talk about chronic infection. So this other talk has no videos, but I try to put as much pictures as possible. So as you all know, when you have a long bone defect, this is a major challenge for all orthopedic surgeons worldwide, because the ultimate goal, of course, is to salvage the limb, whatever the etiology of the bone loss. However, in this particular talk, we will discuss only about chronic infection and delayed union related to infectious complication. So having said so, you all know that today there is no specific technique that is able to manage such wide long bone defects successfully. And we have different techniques. We have autologous bone graft, but usually this works for relatively small bone loss, not more than 6 centimeters usually. And then you have a graft resorption, many issues with this. Then you have techniques like a vascularized bone graft. This is more reliable, but it's technically demanding. It lasts a lot of time. Donor sites are limited. So this again is not perfect. Or you have even more complex technique like the bone transfer, according to the Elizarov principle. But this again is very demanding, not only for the surgeon, but also for the patient. And in this particular technique, really the cooperation of the patient, as you all know, is critical. And then we have the induced membrane technique. This technique, as I said before, was developed by Professor Masquelet in France more than 30 years ago, and was initially developed to address bone defects more than 15 centimeters. But then, because we became more confident with the technique, the indication have been extended, and now it has been shown that it can address defect up to 25 centimeters. So this technique is based on few basic principles. So I'm going to highlight this principle, because even if this technique seems to be quite, let's say, straightforward, it's very demanding, and the most demanding point is the respect of the principle. So first, and then I will go through these points again in my talk. So really is important, because we are dealing with a chronic infection, is important a radical debridement. Once you have a bone that is left in place, that is healthy enough, you can start planning the procedure by the insertion of the cement spacer, and I will show you how you should do this. And then after a certain amount of time, you can remove the cement spacer, but you have to remove just the cement, because by that time, theoretically, the membrane will have formed, the soft tissue around would have somehow healed, and you have to leave in place this soft tissue and the membrane to provide a good environment for the bone to reconstruct. And only at that time you can so go into this second stage, which is the bone graft to fill the cavity of the bone loss. So now I go through the details of the technique. So as I said, important is paying attention to the details and to the basic concepts. This principle really should be followed strictly, and you should be patient, because the technique can give good results, but is somehow time consuming. So be patient and you will see the results. So the first point, as I said, radical debridement is mandatory. Really, eradication of the infection, it what has to be done. You have to have a healthy environment to start doing this technique. You cannot do this technique on an infected bone. The bone can be reconstructed only once the soft tissue and or the residual bone are clean. So really, the debridement must concern all the infected tissue and all the infected bone. Why? Because when you have tissue that is devitalized, this is an hiatus for a recurrent infection, and increase exponentially the risk for delayed union, non-union, and vascular thrombosis. So radical debridement, as you can see here, some example. Important is to remove the sequestrum, to do a sequestrectomy if you have a sequestrum, because the sequestrum, as you all know better than me, is where the pathogens are. Then, if you can leave some bone, as you can see in this case of a full infection of the femur, you really have to bite the bone to remove the bone until you reach the until you have the paprika sign. What is the paprika sign? You remove all the bone that is sclerotic, all the bone that is not alive, and you start seeing some small bleeding coming from the bone, especially if you use a small drill on the top of this bone. When you start seeing coming back this small bleeding, you know that the bony tissue that you eventually left in place is alive. Then, now you have clean all the tissue and you can prepare the cement spacer. You have to prepare it and to put it into the defect. So you have two types of cement you can use, with or without antibiotics. So how to do this? You don't want first that the cement, if there is any bone left, that the cement attaches to the bone. So you start preparing, as I show here in the picture, the cement. You wait that it start to harden outside the bone. When it becomes some sort of a chewing gum consistency, you take it and you put it into the defect, so you can perfectly shape the cement according to the size and the length of the defect. Then you remove it again from the bone and you put it outside, and you wait for the cement to harden. Once has become hard enough, you put it back, you close the skin, and you decide which kind of immobilization you need to use for the patient. So here are the details. So you start preparing the cement. As you can see from the picture, you put it into the defect and you mold it according to the defect. At this stage, the cement is a chewing gum-like consistency, so it won't attach to the bone. You can remove it outside, as you can see, with the desired shape, and you wait until the spacer become hard outside the bone at this stage of hardening. And then again, your spacer can be put back to check if it fits, if it perfectly fits the defect. Otherwise, with a ranger or something, you can adjust it if needed. Then, this is important, especially if you use cement with antibiotics. You have to make multiple holes into the cement, because by making multiple holes, you will increase the surface of the cement and will increase the amount of antibiotic delivery locally. And then, as you can see, you put it back, and in my opinion, if possible, you should try to close the skin directly without doing flap, skin flap, muscular flap, or whatever. It would be ideal if you could close the skin per prima intention. And then you immobilize the patient, cast or external fixation. It's important to provide some rigid fixation. In my experience, I always use the cast with good and bad outcome, but I didn't want to put an external fixator on an infected bone, because I just wanted to have eradication of the infection is my goal. I don't want to give any chance to the pathogens to infect again the bone. So then you put, as I said, the cement, you close, and then you immobilize the patient, then you wait. You wait for a couple of months, and after 6 to 8 weeks, you remove the cement. You have to be careful to remove the cement in one piece and to avoid damaging the soft tissue surrounding the defect. If you have enough bone, you have to refresh the bone margins and to remove all the non-viable tissues. So really now you have a sterile and a clean environment. So as you can see in those cases, you don't want to damage the periosteal membrane, because it's this periosteal membrane that will help the bone to reconstruct. And here, one case where the principle were not followed. So this was a patient with an open tibia fracture. As you can see here, they try to do an induced membrane technique with a very little debridement and a very small cement spacer at the level of the non-union site. So as you can see, on the top of it, over a bone that where the infection was not eradicated, they put a plate. So now they put the hardware over the infected bone, and this is the reason why the technique initially performed with the wrong basis didn't provide the expected results. So really it's important to understand at this stage what is the role of the cement spacer, why we are putting this spacer. Because we want to have a foreign body stimulating the inflammatory reaction. And also we want a spacer because we want something that avoids the collapse of the soft tissue into the defect. So we really want something that provides inflammatory reaction and to keep this cavity, this defect empty, because this empty defect will be the place where you will put your graft, your bone substitute to reconstruct the bone. So really here brings why we call this induced membrane. It is induced membrane because it's induced by a foreign body. And why the induced membrane, as you can see here, works? Because it's highly vascularized, and also because you can identify in the membrane two portions, the inner portion and the outer portion. The most important part is the inner part, where it is synovial-like epithelium, so richly vascularized. And it's really from this inner epithelium that the blood will directly pour into the cavity, nourishing the bone graft and helping the bone to reconstruct. The outer part is still vascularized, but is mostly made of fibroblast, myofibroblast, and collagen. So it's really the structure of the membrane. It's not the active part of the membrane. So really, this membrane is highly vascularized, but also delivers in situ a lot of growth factors that will help the bone to heal and to grow back. So really is a sort of a chambers where you deliver in situ, inside the chambers, the products needed to the bone to reconstruct. So it acts like a biological chamber that keep the graft together, avoids its resorption. So then you have to decide which kind of bone graft you put into the defect. So in my experience, we have been using different products, but I think that if it's possible, is the natural, is the autologous bone graft that should be preferred. We have been also using bisphosphonate, BMP, hydroxyapatite, tobramycin prepackaged calcium sulfate pellets as well. So bone graft or bone substitute, we try to look this in our experience, but we found similar results. But when I look at my patient critically, I think that when you use autologous bone graft, if you have enough bone, it's probably better. The issues is that with the autologous bone graft, you mostly, because the defect is most of the time significant, you just have one shot. And this is our experience that I did with one of my colleagues with these calcium sulfato pellets. And we use them, but as you can see here, we use them for smaller defects. So we're chronic infection, but a good outcome, but for smaller defect. So let's go back to our induced membrane. So once we have clean bone, clean environment, we can also use a hardware at that point, as we did in this case. You put the hardware and you put the graft around. Here, another case where we did the technique for a defect of about 8 centimeters at the level of the distal humerus. And as you can see, the application of a stable fixation provided a good outcome. Then it's important also to just spend a few words about the soft tissue coverage during the first and the second stage. I think that technically you should choose the least technically demanding procedure because you just want to have the skin close. If possible, skin graft, muscular flap should be avoided, in my opinion. You should use primary closure, and to help you to achieve primary closure, we have been started using the VAC system directly on the bone defect. And then of course, you have to treat this patient with antibiotics until usually the markers becomes normal. So this is a case, as you can see, infection of the whole femur following a femoral shaft fracture. The infection was removed, and here you can see the reconstruction. This is another patient with the partial reconstruction of the fibula, about 30 centimeters in length, but not fully circumferential. But as you can see, the reconstruction we had was good. This is another infection of the whole femur. This was a patient that I treated when I was working in China. And as you can see here from the slides, the reconstruction went well. Here again, the details of the case of the distal humerus fracture that was complicated with the chronic infection, graft, plate, and the final outcome. Another case here, chronic infection following this closed fracture, high energy trauma of the distal femur. As you can see from the MRI, we did MRI in this case, the cement pellets that were placed inside the bone. And here you can see the reconstruction few years down the road. This is the very last case we have been treating. I put this case, even if it's in progress, just to show you that the VAC can be used also in young patient. This was a 5 months old, is a 5 months old boy with a Staphylococcus aureus pontum valentine positive infection. We did the debridement and then we did the immobilization into a spica cast, but we don't have again the final outcome because the treatment is in progress. Of course, this is not the technique that can guarantee you 100% of good result. There are failures. In my experience, my failures are around maybe little higher than 20%. It's difficult to say why these failures occur, but I think that probably in patients that had multiple surgeries or they have unhealthy or severely injured soft tissue, these patients are at an increased risk for failure. Here's something that I would define as a partial failure, open tibia fracture. As you can see, this patient was treated elsewhere by is the case that I show you beforehand in my talk with the plate, infected the non-union, so on and so forth. For this patient, we try to improve the quality of the bone and the soft tissue by using a VAC. Then we apply the induced membrane technique. And as you can see here, the fracture didn't heal still, but the last year radiographs show that this outcome, but this year radiograph show that this pseudarthrosis is still in place, but the bone is fully corticalized above and below the pseudarthrosis site. And now the patient is ready to get his nailing and pseudarthrosis resection over a bone that after 2 years of incorrect treatment has become healthy again. And this is, on the other hand, a case of a true failure in my hand. This is a patient that had this kind of open fracture. She was managed with an external fixator, as you can see here. She had a muscular flap to cover the defect. We did apply at the beginning of our technique the induced membrane, and probably we made the mistake to keep the resection as small as possible. We nailed the patient, but the fracture, as you can see, never healed. This was the aesthetic appearance of the flap. The patient had a persistent pain. She was unhappy with the aspect of her leg. Beside that, the fracture never healed. And so this ended up with a transtibial amputation. So this is a true failure of the technique that I reported to you. So in conclusion, I think that this technique should be intended as a valid alternative for the management of large bone defect in children. It has relatively low complication rate if properly applied. However, remember that there are still failures, around 20%, I would say. I think that this technique is also interesting because it doesn't burn bridges. You can still perform other techniques if this fails, but also you can repeat this technique a second time if the first time didn't work well. What is important to understand is that really the key point is to induce the formation of the membrane, because it's the membrane that is a complex bioreactor that continuously deliver growth factor locally directly into your graft. However, you need to have a clean environment because the bone can reconstruct in a proper way. Remember that induced membrane must be combined with the stable fixation. I chose, maybe I'm wrong, not to use external fixator because I don't want to cause a new entry point for pathogens. However, I'm aware that the instability is something that can lead to deformity or non-union, as I show you in the two last cases. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Federico. That was really quite illustrative and interesting. And I think in India, we deal with a lot of infection.
Yes.
And we have about 20 minutes remaining. So I would invite Thomas to present his case. Thomas, are you ready?
Yeah, I'm ready. But I just wanted to, okay, I'll present my case. I have a few questions. I'll share, one second.
Federico, you'll have to unshare your screen.
You want to share or not share?
No, you have to unshare so that Thomas can share his screen.
Okay, so I remove.
While he's unsharing, Federico, I have a question about the percentage of graft. If you have allograft and mixture, how much of allograft and how much of autograft do you have to put?
In the case we mix and, the two.
The timing for your second stage. And the timing for your second stage. Is it 4 weeks, 6 weeks, or which is better? Because there was some paper coming out of, I think, Finland, which said 4 weeks is the best time when these these growth factors are highest.
In my opinion, if we start from the time of length of the spacer, how much time you need to keep the spacer in place, I think this is function of the age of the patient. The younger the patient, the less the spacer can stay. So in my hand, the younger boy, 5 months old, he had the spacer for 4 weeks. Okay. Whereas the older patients had always 6 to 8 weeks. And we noticed that in these severe cases, because our protocol is no more than 8 weeks, we noticed that the membrane was not as good as in younger patient that had the spacer in for 8 weeks. So probably really the age is the key factor for the length of the spacer.
And what about the proportion of graft? Suppose it's a child, we don't have so much of autograft. If we have to mix some other graft, what proportion do you advise us to mix?
If it's possible, I would say 50-50. This is what I've been done.
Okay.
But this is just a clinical observation I made, is that when you used bone substitute, the process of bone reconstruction is much longer.
Okay.
Okay.
So Thomas, I just have one. I think I did everything wrong from what the expert said. This I did for a trauma. There was an external fixator. There was a flap. So maybe the experts can comment on this. So this is from CMC. This is a child who came with a trauma, 12-year-old boy. He was riding pillion on a scooter. We have a lot of road traffic accidents. So he actually fell off a scooter pillion and a bus wheel ran over his leg. So he was initially treated in a nearby state hospital and referred to us the next day, 12 hours later. This was the leg. It was an open fracture, 3B. You can see totally crushed. I don't have a clinical picture, but on the same leg, he had an ipsilateral shaft femur and something here. He had a type 4 medial condyle also, okay? So we took him up the next day. We percutaneously fixed the Salter Harris 4 medial condyle and we did a SN or a titanium nail for the femur, all closed. And then we put on external fixator and debrided radically first stage. And a week later, we went back in again. And then when everything was clean, we put this antibiotic spacer. But unlike what Federico said, I didn't make holes in the antibiotic and I didn't take it out for it to harden and then put it back in. And then 6 weeks later, when the pseudomembrane had formed, we thought this fibula fracture had united and I tried doing this was the picture, the clinical photo had the big defect. And so we had to actually do a flap The plastic surgeons came and did a close muscle and did a fascio, a ponton fasciocutaneous flap over this part. Then 6 weeks later, we went in, we anterolaterally did a Brown's transfer, but unfortunately broke at that fibula fracture site. But on the lateral, it looks, you know, reasonably all right. Still on the fixator, 4 months down, it's all sort of formed like a cross union. And this child is still in evolution. But listening to Frederico, I've done everything wrong, you see. I have done it for a trauma, big defect. Put an external fixator, has a flap. So this is the stage now. So I want both the experts, French experts, to say what I should do next.
So who starts, me or?
Oh, hey, you, please go ahead.
Whoever. You can start, Frederico.
I go?
Yeah.
I think that, in my opinion, maybe we should for sure revise the construct. So use a more stable external fixator, more rigid kind of fixation, because this is just two pins below and two pins above. So maybe it allows some micro movement or some sort of movement at the fracture site, which may preclude the union.
Yeah, and we also have a slab, but we took off the slab for the X-ray.
Okay. And then my other question is, now the skin is closed, everything is okay, yeah, or flap, is still?
The flap is okay. The skin is okay. But the radiological union here,
yes,
and here, although there is some union here, the union there, there although there is some periosteum forming and some bone there, here is okay. But here, my worry is here, there.
I think that first you have to be sure that everything is clean.
Yeah.
That there is no residual infection. If this delayed union is just because it's delayed, it's not because it's delayed because of an infection,
okay,
then you could, in my opinion, graft.
Generally, how long does your masculate take? Does it take 8 months, 10 months for union?
Sometimes even more.
Oh, 12 months.
The problem is that, I mean, once you have to wait for the graft to become a new bone, it can take longer, longer time. It's not a matter of weeks, it's a matter of months.
Dr. Di Meglio, any comments?
I think that you have to change the external fixation because you have to get for more solid external fixation first.
Okay.
In this case.
Okay, so I think both of them feel that the stability is not adequate and it needs to be changed.
Yes.
And
we have limited experience on masculase, so.
And then I think you add bone graft. Is that right?
Yes. Because if you already have the soft tissue that have recovered, so you have to provide healing below and above. Then some cross union happen. This will increase the stability of the bone later on. But for sure, you have to make sure, in my opinion, that the construct is stable. Second, that this area is not healing because it's just a delayed union, not because there is an ongoing infection.
Okay.
And then if it's just a matter of delayed union, then you can graft the area where the union is not there yet.
Okay, so Thomas, if you have further follow up, or should I go to my case? Because we have only 7 minutes.
I'll stop my sharing.
Okay. So I'll just show again. We have a very little time remaining. I'll just show one case where we had infected radius with a large sequestrum there with discharging sinuses, a fracture which was treated by a local osteopath bone setter with a tight bandage, which eventually got infected. So here we have a complex problem of loss of bone, loss of soft tissue, discharge, active infection, and a growth plate injury, which is got affected. So what was done was, as Federico has pointed out, can you see the screen?
No, not yet, not yet.
Oh, sorry, sorry. Let me just go back. I didn't share my screen. I will have to share screen now. Yeah.
Yeah. Now it's come.
Yeah. Sorry. Sorry for that. Yeah. So this is this was the picture. A chronic osteomyelitis with a dead piece of bone there with discharging sinuses and a dislocated inferior radioulnar and radiocarpal joint. We get a lot of these kind of cases. So radical debridement at first stage, identification of the organism, which was Staph aureus, and 5 to 7 days of IV antibiotic followed by 3 weeks of oral linezolid was given. When the infection was cleared and everything was dried up, now we had a soft tissue contracture with a length issue. So what we did here was we put an external fixator and we have this mini fixator and we stretched out the soft tissue. So Federico, we have found in children, I've done a lot of these in India, a soft tissue distraction also creates a sort of a membrane. It revascularizes if you have healthy environment, a bed which is healthy, and then we can get this aligned so nicely. You can see the bone starts looking better. It's like functional rehab. And yeah. Then once we have this kind of length restored, then I use a fibular graft, a long cortical strut, stabilize it with a K-wire and leave the fixator on as an additional immobilizer. And that throws new bone and we can reconstruct the forearm pretty well. And this, as you can see, has gone on to heal pretty well. And that is his 3-month follow-up x-ray. The fixator is off now. Now he's in a splint. And as the bone graft consolidates, I will take it off. And you can see that new bone formation at both the ends. And since it's locked down right now, patient couldn't come for follow-up. But this is his latest x-ray, which he sent from his hometown, which shows that it's quite nicely consolidated and the hand is functioning pretty decently well. So we've published this. We've written this up and published in 2013. Long segment defects reconstructed by non-vascularized bone grafts. And I'll just show you one more case here. And probably I will stop after that because of the time constraint.
That was a pretty long segment, Sandeep.
Yeah. So I have a lot of cases with long segments exceeding 10 centimeters.
That is because of
I've got a lot. That's why we published it. Yeah. So this is a tibia again. The whole tibia came off, and again collapse there, soft tissue distraction, and then I used the fibula from the same side, and I went subperiosteal. I removed the growth plate here because I didn't want it to overgrow, and I put that as a graft. And you can see that the fibula has come back without the head there, so that it's not going to overgrow, and it healed very well. And we've been successful, and then we just do a lengthening at the second stage. And again, I'll just ignore this case. A femur, a long segment femoral defect here again, which we have reconstructed with a fibula. And I put a mini external fixator again. What we found is that it started throwing bone, but because there was instability, it went into a hypertrophic sort of a non-union. And then we just plated it and it healed beautifully. So there's no bone graft here. As long as you can get rid of infection, distract the soft tissues and have a healthy bed, the fibula acts wonderfully well to recreate the lost bone in whatever situation. And like I said, we have published a series of 26 cases, but over the last 7 years, we have, I think, 20, 25 more. So humerus, ulna, you name the long bone, we have done it everywhere. So this is the ulna reconstructed, the humerus reconstructed. So I think we found a good solution to suit our requirement here. So Yeah. I think I'll stop here.
I think the point is the stretching of the tissue.
Absolutely.
That makes the environment good enough.
Absolutely, absolutely. And so I think we agree on the concept that the infections in bone should be treated like a tumor. The debridement must be radical.
Yes.
And then we believe that functional rehab or creating a spacer to create biological healthy environment. If you can give them a good bed, and then you reconstruct with whatever kind of graft you want, either the way you did it or the way I did it, the surrounding tissue tends to heal well.
Yeah. Yes. You have to prepare the environment to the technique you are deciding to use.
Yes, and you must provide adequate stability. If it is unstable, it goes into a healing but a non-union, which may need a better stability second stage. Yes. So, Alain, any final comments before we wind up?
I think that it is a spectacular procedure, the muscular procedure. I think that first, we have to think about the magic of the membrane. It's a great step in the work of Masculine, based on a lot of research. He has done a lot of research to describe the biology of the membrane. Second point, you discover in the presentation that you have not only the membrane, but you have to get good stability. You have to clean the infection first. And if you don't clean the infection, you will not control the situation. You have not to be timid in your resection. You have to be generous. You have to be generous. And third, you discover that the soft tissue play a big role. If you have good soft tissue, you can clothe the skin or use plastic surgery also. And with this, by stability, by detail in the cleaning, bone graft, you can control the infection. So you can combine different procedure and avoid also the retraction of the tissue around the gap, you see, which is also very important. Whatever you use, external fixation, but anyway, it's a long procedure. It takes some time, 1 year, maybe 18 months to control the situation. And you have to give this information to the patient, you see.
I think the novelty of the masculine is it's straightforward. Doesn't involve a technical thing like the microvascular fibula. Doesn't involve Elizaro, the other options, no? So this is fairly, it can be done by anywhere in India, actually, where the infection which is rampant doesn't require expertise. Only thing is the duration of, like Federico was saying, 10 months, when do you wait there, 10 months to 1 year? That is the issue, I think.
So it's been,
maybe it's a good
time. I think it's been wonderful interacting with a gentleman from France. And two really innovative techniques, a percutaneous pelvic osteotomy and a masculate technique with induced membrane. On behalf of POSI, let me thank Federico Canavesi for sparing his time and Professor Alain, who's like a mentor and a father figure to POSI. Thank you very much, both of you gentlemen, and Dhiren Bhai and Thomas again, and Ashok and Neeraj for hosting this webinar for us. So good night, friends, and we hope to see you soon again.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Yes, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye. Bye-bye.
Bye. Thank you.